it's hard to point at any one incident. That's a little bit pseudoscientific to say, well, these people here came to my emergency department today because of climate change. But the science is overwhelming. We have a big problem.
It's important enough for a bunch of doctors to get together and be on camera, which is not something that we do.
We have to address this, and the sooner the better.
Climate change is here now and is impacting health now.
We think of climate change, and climate change seems like such a, you know, a pleasant word. It's a little bit of change. It sounds incremental. Maybe we'll have a little bit stronger hurricanes, but it's not that big a deal. But it is a big deal when you start looking at the data. The health impacts basically fall into five areas, and there are different ways of, you know, slicing and dicing these, but basically heat-related disorders, respiratory and allergic disorders, infectious diseases, injuries and other consequences of extreme weather events, and mental health issues related to all of them.
Air quality and impacts on health has been around for centuries. Once the Industrial Revolution started back in the early 1800s, there's been an increase in the amount of cardiopulmonary, so heart and lung disease, as well as asthma and allergies.
The National Academy of Sciences came out, so nonpartisan organization, great organization, came out with a report saying 107,000 Americans a year are dying from air pollution. We're not even talking about climate change yet. We're just talking about the pollution that will lead to the climate change.
There's kind of two sort of big areas. One is their particulate matter, and particulate matter is fine particles that you can't see, but that can dwell deep in the lung. And ozone as well is sort of another big thing that's triggering for folks with heart and lung disease.
As temperature rises, our pollutants in the air come down to the ground level. And ground level ozone is a big problem that people don't connect to temperature change, but something that affects the quality of air that we breathe. Reduced air quality affects all of us, but some people it affects more, especially kids. So studies have shown that kids, actually, their lung function does not develop properly if they are exposed to high levels of ozone, high levels of other pollutants. That's something that's gonna affect that kid, obviously, for the rest of their life.
Yeah, asthma is very common. It's one of the most common problems in pediatrics, respiratory problems. So children, once they get through the newborn period and all of that, they're pretty healthy. They should just be bumping right along and having fun, and no child wants to ever stop playing or doing things they like to do. So they only slow down when something really hits them pretty hard.
There is a website, airnow.gov, where you can look at your, I think, zip code and look at your air quality. You do want to care about the air you're breathing, because the amount of folks with asthma and allergies is pretty high, and they're going to sort of be triggered or not be able to kind of fully participate at school or work if they're not feeling well with this. And that's a fairly high percentage of the population.
So people who suffer from hay fever, and I have a little bit of myself, okay, but not very bad, but there are people who really have bad nasal congestion, sneezing, eyes watering, and that's already getting worse because plants are putting out more pollen with higher temperatures, and the pollen seasons are longer. In fact, there's some data to say that they're already 3 weeks longer.
So the Northeast is the area of the United States that is warming at a faster rate than any part of the country. So certainly heat's on my mind a lot more. you know? And so I'm asking, do you have an air conditioner? You know, if I know that there's heat coming up and that I have a patient with cardiovascular disease or diabetes, you know, on my mind a lot more is the safety of their home setting in the midst of a lot of these heat waves.
I encourage families to just really be prepared and aware of their surroundings. So if you're gonna be outside for a prolonged period of time with heat exposure, make sure you have access to different ways to hydrate. Make sure you have a place to cool down. Make sure you're taking breaks between long stretches of physical activity.
It's pretty clear that very hot weather, it's not good for most people. At Cambridge Hospital, for example, on hotter days, we're definitely going to see more emergency room admissions.
When the heat waves come through, they cause a rush of heart attacks and strokes. This is known. We will see more respiratory emergencies, more infectious diseases in Massachusetts as the temperature warms.
I think anybody who's trained in infectious diseases is uniquely aware of the fact that human illness, the illnesses that we deal with, are intimately related to what's happening in the world around us. Our specialty is unique because it is not one that deals just with the human. It deals also with the organism that causes an infection. And many times those organisms exist in the environment.
The two diseases that we're primarily concerned about here, although there can be others, of course, but in Massachusetts, we're concerned about Lyme disease being transmitted by ticks and West Nile virus and other viruses that can be transmitted by mosquitoes.
Their habitat is changing, and that in turn is going to affect us. So when we don't have a very cold winter, things like ticks and mosquitoes that normally like go to ground in the winter don't necessarily. So they stay more active. So then they have a much longer breeding season. And then there's just more of them and more of them that carry disease.
They're likely to be seen farther into the fall and earlier in the spring because of the warming climate. And so we've seen cases of Lyme disease, for example, in December. We've seen them early in the spring.
Their habitat has been spreading. They're moving further and further through the state.
So we are going to have to tell people to be much more careful about avoiding insects. If your kids are playing sports, it needs to be clear that you want to avoid mosquito bites.
We really got to expand the kind of diseases we're thinking about because climate change is changing the prevalence of some of those diseases in the area.
And all of these things, we look, of course, first at the direct effects in terms of pathophysiology, the effect of poor air quality, of higher concentration of pollen allergens in the community, and how that disrupts my life physically. But the psychological effects, they're profound and they're evident to everybody who suffers.
One of the ways that we see mental health affected is through severe weather or because of severe weather. Severe weather we know is linked to climate change, and we can also link depression, anxiety, even PTSD to severe weather.
During a storm, both in the summer and the winter, there's injuries, there's death, and there's a lot of impact on mental health and stress if you're impacted really in any way, even if as bad as if you're displaced and have to go somewhere else. It's extremely stressful.
You know, something I think a lot about is the psychological impact of feeling this threat. You know, we're a coastal state, and a lot of our communities are right on the coastline. And so you look at the maps of what different levels of warming could cause in terms of flooding, and that people will be impacted in this way and have to think about moving. Those are real threats.
We're sort of in the early stages of trying to get our collective minds around this, the kind of existential unease that accompanies a threat of this scale. But I think realistically we have reason to try to respond to it now, even if we don't know all the answers.
I mean, my response to those feelings was one of, you know, action and engagement and hope. And for me, it's been empowering. And I also recognize that I'm not gonna be perfect, because we exist in a in a system, you know, that is built in a certain way. We have roads, we have cars, we have coal-powered power plants. Like, some of that I can't change immediately. But I feel comfortable that I'm trying to live my life in a way that fits with my thinking about what's happening in the world. And then that leads me to feel empowered to be involved in my community.
So I think there's so many things that people can do in their own community. Taking public transportation if you can, instead of driving yourself in your car, or riding your bike or walking to work. It can be figuring out what you don't have in your community and what would be helpful, and then advocating for those things. Maybe getting a cooling center if they don't have one already, making sure that they do have one for those really hot days. Or making sure there are bike paths, making sure there are sidewalks that are safe for people to walk so that they don't have to drive.
Cities that have reduced pollution have seen health benefit. So this is a fixable problem. If I thought this was truly hopeless, I wouldn't bother. I'd go do other things. But it's not. It's actually a fixable problem. It's analogous to having high blood pressure or a tobacco abuse problem. You can fix those things.
Climate change is occurring. It's happening. And yes, it's something we hear on the news, but it's also something that is affecting our health and our ability to enjoy life. And we need to pay attention to it. It does affect us all, if not directly, then indirectly in a very powerful way. And there's a call for all of us to be involved in a solution going forward.